Darkness has been banished.
God's light fills the world.
God's light has come for all of us.
Lord, prepare us to journey to your light.
Prepare our hearts for the light of God's grace. Thanks be to God.
Please join me to hymn 375.
Page 545 of your Bible. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem, praise your God, O Zion. For he strengthens the bars of your gates, he blesses your sons within you. He makes peace in your borders, he fills you with the finest family. He sends forth his command to the earth, his word runs swiftly. He gives snow like wool, he scatters hoar frost like ashes, he casts forth his ice like morsels. Who can stand before his cold? He sends forth his word and melts them. He makes his wind blow and the waters flow.
Second reading is from John 1, verses 10 through 18, found on page 922 of your Pew Bible. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world knew him not. He came to his own home, and his own people received him not. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of the man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. We have beheld his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father. John bore witness to him and cried, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, for he was before me.' And from his fullness have we all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, only the Son, who is in the bosom of the Father. He has made him known." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please now sing one verse of Jesus Loves Me for Time with Children.
Forever. Probably not, because I probably either they're going to break this or lose it at some point. I know I'll lose the earring, I always lose earrings, so I don't plan on holding on to those for forever. The only way to do that would be leave them in the box. Anyway, are your clothes, do they last forever? You know, either we outgrow them, or they wear out, or we stain them, usually what I do. So they don't last forever either. But do you guys know that you all got one thing that's going to last forever for Christmas? What did you get?
Jesus.
We got Jesus, that's right. He's a gift that lasts forever. And Jesus came to us Christmas morning, and he stays with us throughout our whole life. And if we believe that Jesus is our Savior, we become children of God. And God promises us in the Bible that he will take care of us forever. And then when we pass on to the next life, we go live with him in heaven. So it's a gift that truly never ends. Isn't that amazing? Yeah, so remember this year, in 2016, as you wake up every morning, to thank God every day for that wonderful gift he gives you, Christmas, the gift that never ends. Okay? Let's say a prayer.
Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus to make us your children and for loving us throughout our whole lives and into eternity. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, John, I'm very glad you talked about Christmas because, you know, it is still Christmas season in the church year. And this was a present I didn't receive this Christmas, but I got last Christmas. This skull. So, you know, there's a limited amount of time you can wear it. So I'm wearing it again this Sunday because it's still Christmas. Even though we've turned the calendar to 2016. It's still the Christmas season here, so we still do have our Christmas tree up. We have decorations around the sanctuary, and we are reminded that Christmas continues. Of course, we have our beautiful banner with the first Christmas gift right there depicted for us in the Christmas banner. And I came in this morning, and Tom back here asked me, when is the next time you're going to... How did you phrase that, Tom?
What? Act crazy.
Act crazy. That's what I'm saying. Act crazy. What are you going to act crazy again here in church? So I'm not sure what he means by that, but we'll see. I did think about, since this message is titled Grace Upon Grace, I did consider briefly singing Amazing Grace for you, but we're all going to get to sing it after the message. I think that'll be a lot better. That particular rendition. But crazy, I'm not sure exactly what Tom means, but this being the first Sunday of 2016, I did think that I would start off with a story. Maybe not crazy, but actually this is a very short story. It's very brief, just as sort of an introduction to the message this morning. And it's a story that I heard a couple of years ago that had made an impression on me. And it was the story, it's a story that actually took place on New Year's Eve. And it was on New Year's Eve about 10 years ago now, when this country was going through some pretty tough financial times. There were a lot of things that were going on, and a lot of businesses had gone under around that time. And as this story goes, there was a boss at a fairly large company, not a huge corporation, but a fairly large company that had a lot of employees. And this particular boss, on New Year's Eve, when you traditionally have parties and everything at work perhaps, on this particular New Year's Eve, this boss went around to several different employees of that company and talked to them individually, and they were important employees. Some of them had been there 10, 15, or even 20 years in this particular company, and this boss had to tell them that they could no longer afford to keep them at the company. The company was downsizing, and he was telling each of these individual employees that they were losing their job in the following year, which also happened to be the next day. This was their last day on the job with this particular company. Now, as you can imagine, this news spread like wildfire throughout this particular company. And all the employees were either discussing or cussing that particular boss for the way that he had handled this particular affair, and waited until the very last day of the year, their very last work day, to tell them that this is it, that you're losing your job in this particular business. And so there were all kinds of vile things that were being said about this particular boss, and all kinds of words, which obviously I can't repeat here on Sunday morning, to describe what a terrible boss this was in this particular company to act in this particular way. However, there was, as was discovered in the next few days and next few weeks by various people in the company, the ones that remained, there was one saving grace for this particular boss, because secretly, unbeknownst to anyone else in the company, this boss had spent hours and hours and hours in the weeks and in the very important 2 months of November and December before his announcement to the employees. He'd spent hours and hours and hours talking to other companies and to other businesses in that area, and he had actually secured a job offer for each and every one of those employees at a different company that he had had to let go from his company. And he told those employees that, as he was letting them go, that you do have a job offer. Of course, it was up to them to take it. And that seemed to be his one saving grace. And a few of the employees, as they began to hear about this, their feelings changed a little bit about this particular boss. And as the story goes, many of those former employees did take those job offers and were able to stay in the area and to stay in that sort of the same type of business. Some of them decided not to. Some of them retired early. Some of them just decided, I don't want to do this anymore, this kind of business, and went on to something else. So the story had sort of a mixed ending as far as it was concerned. And actually, I'm not even certain that this story actually happened, if it's a true story or not. I heard it my first year in seminary. And things you hear in seminary, you're supposed to believe. But because I never heard what the company was or any names or anything associated with it. But regardless of whether this particular story actually occurred or not, there were lots of tragedies like this that were taking place in the 10 years preceding this year. Where our economy was in pretty rough shape, and a lot of companies were downsizing, a lot of people were losing their jobs, and it was very difficult for many people in many professions to find new jobs and to find new work. But the thing that stuck out to me in this particular story was that one little line, that one little phrase, one saving grace. And it referred to the fact that there was one thing that this boss had done that sort of made a lot of the employees forgive him or her for this particular act, and that thing was trying to find new job opportunities for all the employees he had to fire to save that company. And I kept coming back to that phrase, one saving grace. After all the vile things that had been said about this person, and all the evil thoughts that had been directed in his direction by the former employees and the present employees of that particular company, yet there was still one saving grace. One thing that this wicked-seeming person, this evil person actually did, that most people didn't know about at the time, that made them forgive him for the actions that he had to take. And so one saving grace, and we hear that, we see that, if you see or watch a lot of the, which I did, because Julia really enjoys them, a lot of the Hallmark Christmas stories, the TV, they make like a million of them. You see them over and over and over. Basically, it's the same story, right, actually. But there's always sort of a bad person in there as well. There's always the one saving grace about that person. There's something, even though they're not very nice, there's something about that person that you can say, well, okay, maybe they're not as bad as we actually think. Maybe I can forgive them for that particular action. As in this story, maybe the people actually could forgive that boss for having to let those employees go because of the work he put in and the actions he took to try to make sure that they still have at least an opportunity to have a job as the new year began. Grace, one saving grace. Grace is a word that is found as often as almost any other word in our scriptures, in the Bible. There are not too many other words that are found more often than that, the words of meaning, besides just adjectives and various different things. But grace is found all throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament. It speaks about grace. And generally, when the Bible is talking about grace, simply put, it's talking about mercy and forgiveness. Undeserved forgiveness when the Bible mentions grace. And it's almost always attributed to God. As a matter of fact, the adjective that I use most often to describe God, and I know some of you now are trying to figure this out as you listen to me throughout the next few weeks, is gracious. Gracious God. The Bible describes a gracious God. The Bible describes a God not that just has one saving grace, but a God that offers grace to all. Grace upon grace, as we heard read this morning. Even to us, even to me, a terrible sinner for all of my life, all the things that I've done wrong, all I have to do is repent and turn to God, and God offers grace to me. That's what it says in the words of Amazing Grace, which we will sing here shortly. A hymn that has an okay little tune to it, but we all know it, we all hear it. It resonates with us when we hear the words of Amazing Grace. It is actually one of the three hymns that Pat Parker chose for her own funeral service this past week. And it's very commonly used in funeral services and in a lot of different places in our society. Almost everybody, even if they're not church members and they don't go to church regularly, they know the song Amazing Grace. And it talks about how God's amazing grace is extended to each and every person in the world. Even a wretch like me. Even a wretch like me. So the focus of my message this morning is God's grace upon grace. What was John talking about when he said that in this passage this morning? Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When they were reading through and thinking about the youth in here and preparing for leading the worship this morning, and Caden had the job of reading the scripture there. He was going through the scripture up here, and Jill was standing here beside him and saying, okay, he got to verse 16, and she said, this one's important. This has got to be important right here. Because it says grace upon grace in that verse, and so I repeated that. So I don't know if you noticed, but he did an astounding job on verse 16. He got to that, and he read that particular verse this morning. John speaks of Jesus benefiting his people with one gracious blessing after another in verse 15. And in verse 16, he describes this as grace upon grace. And John was affirming that in his knowledge of Jesus as the Son of God, that he had never found Jesus lacking in any way. John's description here, I think, conveys a subtle invitation for us to trust Jesus' ability to meet our needs. That we've all been benefited includes all the believers, not just John and the apostles, but all believers receive God's blessings. For nothing can deplete God. No matter how much the believers, no matter how much we receive of God, God keeps on giving. The blessings of God, God's grace, can never be exhausted. And grace comes at no cost to ourselves. Forgiveness, God's forgiveness can never be earned. We can never do anything that's going to earn God's forgiveness. It's just the fruit of God's love. We actually get something for nothing. Wow, that's very hard for us to believe today in the 21st century in the United States of America. We actually get something for nothing. That's exactly what we're promised in the scriptures when it talks about God's grace. Philip Yancey, in his book, What's So Amazing About Grace, he says, and I quote, "It's on tap for every person. One who has been touched by grace will no longer look on those who stray as evil people or those people who need our help. Nor must we, as those who have received God's grace, must not search for signs of love-worthiness in ourselves or other people. Grace teaches us that God loves because of who God is, not because of who we are." End quote. And let me repeat that last line that he says here. Grace teaches us that God loves because of who God is, and not because of who we are. Grace does not depend on what we've done for God, but rather it is what God does for us. You know, if you ask most people, what do you got to do to get to heaven? And, you know, people think about that. And you may say, well, I never really thought about that. Well, you probably have. You're probably going to. You know, what do we have to do? What does it take? What do we have to do to get to heaven? And most people will reply to that, their thought, what they have in their mind is, well, you got to be good to go to heaven. Right? I mean, that's how you get to heaven. You've got to be good. Well, Jesus' story, the whole New Testament contradicts that. It doesn't say you have to be good to go to heaven. All we have to do is cry out, "Help me, God. Help me, God." And turn our lives over to God. Grace does not depend on what we have done for God. Grace depends on what God does for us. Repentance, not proper behavior or not being holy your whole life. Repentance is the doorway to receiving God's grace. And the opposite of sin in our lives is grace. It's not virtue. The opposite of sin is grace. God's grace extended to us. Here's an example. Maybe a silly example, but let me give it a shot. A man dies and goes to heaven. Okay? God dies, goes to heaven. Of course, he meets St. Peter there at the pearly gates. Meets St. Peter there at the pearly gates, and St. Peter says, well, it's getting sort of crowded up here in heaven. We don't have as much room as we thought we were going to need up here, so we've got a new policy. And here's how it works. You need 100 points to get into heaven. You need 100 points to get in here, St. Peter tells the man. So St. Peter says, you've got to tell me all the good things you've done in your life, and I'll give you a certain number of points for each item, depending on how good it was. And when you reach 100 points, if you reach 100 points, you get in. The guy started scratching his head. He started to sweat a little bit, started pulling his collar. Well, I didn't know this is how it worked, but he said, okay, let me try a few things. Let me think about my life. All right, I was married to the same woman for over 50 years, and I never cheated on her, not even in my heart. St. Peter tallies it down there. He said, okay, that's worth 1 point. Oh, 1 point, the man says. Oh, and he thinks as hard as he can, and he goes, well, I attended church all of my life from a child. I went to church as often as I could, almost every Sunday, and I supported my church's ministry with my money and with my service. St. Peter says, well, that's terrific. That's good. That's a half a point. Very good half a point. Gosh, I can't believe. Well, how about this one? It's got to be worse than I started a soup kitchen in my city, And I worked in a shelter for the homeless in our city for over 20 years. St. Peter said, well, that's really great. That's worth like 3/4 of a point. You're slightly over 2 at this point. And he says, I'm only over, that's my whole life. That's all the things that I've been doing. I can't believe it. At this rate, the only way I'll go to heaven is by the grace of God. St. Peter said, well, that's 100 points. He goes in. Paul said in his letters to the churches, that was made, these churches were made up of a mixture of Jews and Gentiles. He said that we are all equally undeserving. We are all of us, equally undeserving. We're justified being just as if I had never sinned, by grace, through faith, not by works. Now, you know, as Christians, we all tend to pay lip service to that. We say, oh yeah, that's right. We're justified by grace. Through faith, we're not justified by the works that we do. We all say that. I bet if you've been to church very often, you've heard people say that, and you realize that, and you think, yeah, that's right. That's what it says in the Bible. We're justified through grace by faith, and not by the things that we do. But have we really taken to heart what it means when it's applied to us? What does that mean? It means that we gain our spiritual strength through God's gracious love. You know, a Christian has often been compared to a light bulb. It's another thing I learned at seminary. They teach you all kinds of little useless bits of information. A Christian is compared to a light bulb. I wish I had one in my hand. I know there's some up there, but they're all connected and turned on. Okay, the light bulb, it can't shine on its own. It can't shine on its own. You know, the electrical power may be there in the electric grid, wherever, you know, hooked in, but the light bulb cannot screw itself in. It cannot turn the power on, and that's the only way that a light bulb does any good whatsoever, if it's plugged in, screwed in, and switched on. Similarly, God's power is available to us as Christians. God's only waiting for us to ask. And then He'll give us the strength of will and the spiritual determination to do the things that we should be doing in our lives. Perhaps doing good deeds for God's kingdom. But we must make the connection. We have to ask. We have to connect ourselves to God. We must pray regularly and passionately that God will give us the spiritual strength. And then God will give us the spiritual strength, or grace, if you will, so that we can do anything that we need to do on behalf of God's kingdom. Anything that God wills for us to do. So what is grace? What is this grace upon grace? Well, grace in a nutshell, at its heart, grace is a loving relationship between a generous God and His trusting worshiper. The loving relationship between a generous God and God's trusting worshipers. It's God's undeserved love, and it's the power that that love then instills in us. Go out and work on God's behalf. And saving grace is a very small step from that. God wants to save each one of us. God wants to save each one of us from the fear of death and the guilt and the power of sin, which we all experience, that fear, that guilt about sin. There's nothing that we have to do to earn God's saving grace. God gives it to us of God's own free will in that second that we truly ask for it. It's given for all people. People who up to now may have lived a terrible life, may have been wicked in their own ways and evil to the core, but it's given to all people, and it's given to us. But no one, not a single one of us, has this saving grace until we repent and put our trust in God. Going back to the story I told you at the beginning of this message of the employer who had that one saving grace, I think most of us would forgive him because of that one saving grace, because of that one thing that he did to make sure that his employees at least had the opportunity to have a new job in the new year. How much more must God search for any redeeming feature in our lives? Looking for any redeeming feature, looking for that saving grace which releases that spring and catapults us into the totally undeserved bliss of the kingdom of God. John wrote, "The Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory. The glory of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. From His fullness, we have all received grace upon grace." Jesus the Son, who is Himself God, can communicate God's glory to us. Jesus is near God's heart, and Jesus is the human being who has told us about God. Jesus is the one who explains God to us. And He came to earth and He lived among us to explain God to us with His words and by His person, by His actions. So when it says, when He says, "Come, follow me," and as Christians we take on that name, we take on that title of Christian, we are truly called to follow the actions of Jesus in His life. Christ shows us the way to live. Christ shows us the path to God. He is, as John said, the Word, by which we can understand what it means to grow close to God and then to receive God's redeeming grace. Grace upon grace. I'd like to close this message with the words from a simple little song that's called "God's Special Child." I'm not going to sing it. Sorry, I'm not going to be crazy today, I guess. But I want to offer this as a prayer, because I think it speaks directly to the heart of God's offering grace to each and every one of us. So shall we pray? I'm special because God loved me, for God gave the best thing that God had to save me, God's own Son, Jesus, crucified to take the blame for all the bad things I have done. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving me so much. I know I don't deserve anything. Help me feel your love right now, to know deep in my heart that I'm God's special child. Amen. Grace upon grace. We now have the opportunity to respond to God's grace by singing that old favorite hymn, "Amazing Grace," which is found on page 343 in your hymnal. Shall we rise together, either in body or spirit, and sing? please join with me now in that Christian affirmation of faith that we know of as the Apostles' Creed, which you find printed in your bulletin this morning. I believe in
God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
saved by God's grace, we all are greatly blessed. We now come to that point in our service where we have an opportunity to give back, to give of what we may have, to share some portion of our tithes as an offering to God to help further God's kingdom on this earth. So as our ushers come forward, be generous in your gifts this day. We ask that you bless them as they may be used for the furthering of your kingdom here in this community and around the world. It is in your holy name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let us now pause for just a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for prayer. Shall we pray? God of grace upon grace, we give you the glory for your love extended to each of us. As the year 2016 now begins, we ask that we may be instruments of your grace, of your peace, of your love, and of your joy to all your children throughout this church, throughout this community, this nation, and this world. May we be a blessing to others as others have been a blessing to us in our lives. Gracious God, there are so many needs in this world. There are those who are going hungry. There are those who face violence. There are those who are suffering illness. There are those who are so, so lonely. But you, gracious God, will offer hope for all. We ask now that you touch all those in need at this time. May your love offer them some comfort. So at this time, we ask that you be with Thelma and Rosalie and Lorraine, Sleeper, the family and friends of Pat Parker, and also be with all those who are unnamed at this time, but who we hold in our hearts, who we hold close and we hold dear. May your spirit comfort them. And continue to be with us now as we repeat the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Let us rise either in body or spirit one last time and sing together our closing hymn, Blow How Rose Air Blooms, number 255. Shall we rise and sing? And if that's not too exciting for most of you, the chancel choir is going to be singing next Sunday. So we'll be ready for that. And we'll have the chancel choir that will be singing here before us. Epiphany Sunday, chancel choir singing, a nice congregational meeting. We're also going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper next Sunday. So I hope you're here for that celebration of communion, our first opportunity to do this in the new year. I'm excited about that, and I hope to see you here for that. And who knows when the pastor will go crazy. You never know, Tom, so we'll just have to wait and see. But a happy new year to all of you as 2016 begins now. We really don't know what's going to unfold this year. We don't know where we will be a year from now, what we might be doing, what we might be involved in. But regardless of what it is, regardless of where you are, regardless of what you're doing during 2016, always remember that God is there with you. For God is above us. God is below us. God goes before us. God is behind us. God stands beside us. And most importantly of all, God is inside us as well. Go in peace, my friends. Amen.